Welcome, Japanese warlords, to the Sekigahara, the Unification of Japan tutorial. Sekigahara is a historical war game set in Japan for two players. Now, before we begin, let me just start by saying that I'll be changing some of the names of the components in this game so it's easier to explain. For example, the Tokugawa army will be the Black Army, and the Ishida army will be the Gold Army. The game is played using these unit blocks. On these blocks are a number of symbols which refer to as mon, and the symbol that's on it represents a daimyo, but I'll refer to those as clans. So each of these blocks has a clan and a number of symbols which will be used when determining combat in this game. With that out of the way, let's get started. Each player will pick one of the two armies and collect all the cards, blocks, and cubes needed for that army. You'll set up the board as I've done here, and one player will sit on one side with the opponent sitting opposite of him. This is the perspective of what the Black Army player will be seeing, and the Gold Army will be sitting across from them. The first thing we will need to do is to set up our starting units at specific locations of the board. These locations are marked with small symbols, such as stars, squares, circles, or triangles. You'll need to dig through your bag of wooden blocks to find the appropriate units with the matching symbols in the bottom right corner. Here are the three starting star units, and they'll be placed at the location with the three stars. When you're placing your units, put them in a stack, one on top of the other, and face them so that they are facing towards you and away from your opponent. Your opponent is not supposed to know which units you have on the board and where. But for the purposes of this tutorial, I'll have both the units facing towards the camera. The gold player will also have these discs which represent specific people, which will be placed at specific locations on the map as such. And there is also one double-sided turn marker which will be set to the side, as it is not owned by either player. The smaller square cube that the players have can be set to the side as they'll be used later. You can tell how many units you'll need at each starting location by the number of the symbols at that location. Once all the starting units which match the symbols on the board have been collected, you'll then draw additional random starting units for areas that have a plus number symbol inside a rounded rectangle. So here at Anotsu it says plus one, here at Kyosu it also says plus one here, at Gifu there's a plus two, Kyoto has a plus two. So you'll take your bag, shuffle it up randomly, and draw a number of random units to go to each location. And for areas that already have a stack there, you'll simply place your units on top, continuing the stack. The order of which the stack is placed is not important. There are recruitment boxes in the corners of the board, which will also need random units to be placed inside of it. These will be available for recruitment during the game, so be sure to place the random starting units at that location. Once all the starting units and random starting units have been placed, each player will shuffle their deck and draw 5 cards from it. The game is played over a series of rounds known as weeks, and during each week, each player will get 2 turns. A week has 3 phases. First will be the reinforcement phase, however for the very first week of the game, we will skip this. The second phase is that the players will bid for the turn order. And the third phase, the players will go back and forth performing their turns. Since we skipped the reinforcement phase, we'll go straight to the bidding. Each player will take a card from their hand and place it face down and reveal them simultaneously. What we're looking for is the number in the bottom right corner for the initiative. Whoever reveals the higher initiative gets to choose to go first. The cards used for the bidding get discarded. So in this example, the black player had the initiative, and they can choose to go first, which they do. They'll take the turn marker, flip it to their side, and place it on the A spot of the week that they're on. Once they perform their turn, it'll be to the opponent, and they'll simply flip it to the opponent's color, still on the A side. Once the gold player finishes their turn, they'll flip it once more to the B side. The black player will get their turn, and so on and so forth. Each week, the players will get to bid again to see who goes first, but the turns will proceed the same way as we just did. Back and forth, until both players have done both their turns and on to the next week. So, the black player gets to go first. When it's your turn, there are two phases to your turn. The movement phase, and then the combat phase. In order to move, you must discard up to two cards. And depending on how many you discard determines what type of movement you can do. You can choose, however, to discard no cards. If you do this, you can discard as many cards as you want from your hand and redraw back up to the number that you discarded. Or, if you discard no cards, you can move one of your stacks. If you discard one card, you can move up to three of your stacks and perform a reinforcement as one of those moves. If you discard two cards, you can move all of your stacks on the table and get a reinforcement for free. So let's talk about reinforcements. As I said, each player will have a recruitment box in the corner of the board, which will show the random tiles that they pulled out of their bags during setup and subsequent turns. If you discard one or more cards, you can optionally do a recruitment. When you recruit any units from this box, you can do one of two things. You can take all of the units that have a matching clan symbol, show them to your opponent so that they know that they all match, and then place them at the recruitment location that also has their clan symbol. So here I could take both these units and put them at Edo. Or you can take any one unit, don't show your opponent what it is, and then put it at any recruitment location. And the recruitment locations are those that has a clan symbol of your team's color. So I could take this unit and place it here or at any other location that has a recruitment symbol. It doesn't have to match the same clan. I should also note that any units that were recruited this turn cannot move. But how do you move? To move, you simply take any number of blocks from a single stack and move them along the roads. But you might incur certain bonuses or penalties depending on some factors. First, the bonuses. When you can move a stack, you can automatically move it one. So I could take all of these four and move it one. Simple. But you could also gain an additional movement for a leadership bonus. A leadership bonus applies if you start your movement at a castle or if you reveal a leader. A leader is any unit that has this flag symbol. Before you perform your move, you can reveal to your opponent, hey, I have a leader in this stack, so I'm going to get an additional movement, just so you know. So I can go 1 and 2. The capitals along the board are Kyoto and Edo. They have the special flowering around the location. Now the leadership bonuses that I mentioned, while you can get them from different sources, you can only get one. So if this player here starts at a castle and has a leader in there, they can't get plus two, only plus one. But at least this way, they don't have to show their opponent that they have a leader in that stack, and can instead say, I'm at a castle, I'm going to take the plus one. The second bonus you can get is if your movement is done entirely along the red highways, you'll get a plus one. So they can move one more space. And lastly, you can discard a card to do a force march, which gives them another plus one. But as I mentioned, you can also incur penalties during your movement. This occurs if you're trying to move a stack of units that is greater than four. For every multiple of four greater than four, you get minus one. So for example, here, if I had this five stack and I wanted to move them, I would get an automatic minus one. So if we were to add up all the bonuses, if I only move along the highway, that's plus one. If I start at castle, that's plus two. If I force march, that's plus three, and I automatically get one. But because I'm moving a stack of five, that's minus one. Also, if your move ever takes you onto a location where the enemy is, your move automatically stops, unless you overrun your opponent. To do this, you're crushing your opponent by your sheer force of numbers. This happens if you move onto a location with your opponent and you have 4 times more than the number of units at that location than your opponent. All the units get destroyed and you get to proceed to your move as normal. So for example here, if there was only 1 unit at that location, I wouldn't stop there and conduct a battle during the battle step. Instead, because I have 5 and they have 1, that's definitely 4 times greater, I will simply destroy them and move along as I wish. Otherwise, I would have to stop and we'd conduct a battle during the battle phase. All movement must be done one after another. So once I'm done moving my first stack, I can choose another stack and move them with the appropriate rules. Other rules that apply. You cannot move down a road that has already been traveled by another unit. For example, I have these 2 units that I want to move. First, I'll move this stack, and I can choose however many units I'd want to move. I can split the stack. I can say, I'll take these 3 and move them down to Kyosu. Great. This road has now been traveled, and so it now cannot be traveled again by my units on the same turn. So I couldn't take this stack at Iwamura, move them to Gifu, that's fine, but I can't move them down to Kyosu, because this road has already been traveled, and so they must either go around or wait for next turn. You can also drop off blocks as you move. So if I take this 5 stack, move them down, I can at any point during this move simply leave behind a few. Although you can't do the reverse, where if I were to start here and move up, I couldn't take all these units with me. I'd have to leave them there and continue my move. Also, once a unit has moved, it cannot move again for the remainder of the turn. So as I was dropping off units, I couldn't then use my other movements to move these guys because they were already a part of a movement. Another thing to keep in mind are these red resource locations along the map. They belong to nobody, but as you move over them, you can claim them by dropping one of your resource tokens on that location. And even if you move off of it, that location still belongs to you, of course, until the enemy goes by and claims it for themselves. There are also these castles along the board. By default, these are aligned to one of the 2 players, either the black player or the gold player. But if you have units at that castle, it is claimed for your team, until you move off of it, in which case it would then go back to its default player. Resources and castles are important, for if the game goes to 7 weeks and nobody has been decided a winner, you would determine the winner by victory points, and that's determined by how many castles and resources each player currently controls. Castles and resource locations are also important for the reinforcement phase, where they will allow you to draw more cards for your hand to conduct possible battles or bid for the first turn, and could give you potential more recruitments to hire during your turn. But let's continue on with the turn. The black player performs their moves, captures any locations, and will pass it off to the second player, because the black player did not end any of their moves in a contested area with their opponent to initiate a fight. So the gold player does want to fight the black player. How will they do this? So during their turn, they'll not discard any cards, but this allows them to at least move 1 stack. So they will. They'll choose which units they want from their stack and move them along. So they'll take the 4 stack that they want and move them along. They get 1 for basic, 2 because they started as a capital, and then 3 because they're discarding a card. And so they'll end their turn and a battle will ensue at Miyazu. Battles can have a lot of special rules to them, but first I'll describe how a basic battle works and then we'll talk about all the special rules that can apply. For example, this location is not a castle, so we don't have to worry about what a siege is. This is a standard battle outside at a location. So how do we conduct it? First, it's not important how many units move onto a location. What matters is whether or not you can deploy those units to the fight. When you deploy units, you will discard cards that match their clan symbol. Then you'll score a number of impact points based on certain factors. And then, once every player is done deploying units, you will tally up the impact points to determine who won and how many forces are lost on each side. So the attacking player always gets the first initiative. They get the first opportunity to deploy a unit. So they can discard a card, or they can discard no cards and deploy one of their leaders. However, this must be done before any units have been deployed on their side. Now remember, this game is conducted so that your opponent can't see which units you've brought to the fight, which is why deployments will reveal what units you're using. So here the gold player reveals their leader, and they will score 1 point because there is one symbol on that leader unit. These points are tracked along the impact track that is on the left side of the board and a single small square. Then a defender will get to deploy one of their units. So they will play a card that has a clan symbol matching the unit that is at the location. And they will reveal. And they will also score 1 point for the one symbol on that unit. After both players get one initial chance to deploy units, the initiative will then go in order of who has the least impact points on the tracker. So in this scenario here, since they are tied, the defender has the initiative. And if they had more units at the location, they could choose to deploy more units by playing more cards. But they don't. So instead, that player will pass. If you pass, you pass for the remainder of the deployment phase. And so your opponent will have as many opportunities as they want to deploy cards until they also pass, and then we'll tally up the score. Let's just say the black player here had more units to make this more interesting. So because of the tie, the initiative is back to the black player, and they will play another card and deploy another unit. And then they will score 2 points for the two symbols on that unit. They are now at 3, and the gold player is at 1. So the gold player wants to play a card. They'll play theirs and place a unit with the matching symbol. And they would score 3 points, which puts the gold player at 4 and the black player at 3. So initiative is back to the black player. They play another card and deploy their unit. So here, they would get 1 point for the number of symbols on that unit they played, but then an additional point for every unit whose symbol matches the unit just played. So because the black player just placed this, they get 1. And because it matches with this unit, they'll get an additional 1, which now puts them at 5, and the gold player at 4. The gold player, not wanting to be one-upped, places another card and does the same thing as well. They play a unit, they score 2 points, and they would score an additional point for the matching symbols. But wait, the black player plays a loyalty challenge. This card is played immediately after your opponent deploys a card, and that makes the unit that was just deployed defect to your side, unless your opponent can reveal another card in their hand which could play that unit. So that means the gold player has to show another card in their hand that matches this symbol, because that would allow you to play that unit. If they can, they simply reveal it and put it back to their hand. The loyalty challenge has been thwarted. If they can't, it defects. And instead, in this example, the black player will score 2 points for the number of symbols on that unit. If, for example, they manage to get 2 units with matching symbols to defect, they would score the same matching symbol bonuses as if they played it on their own team. But anyway, this puts the black player at 7 impact points and the gold player at 4. So they have to play their last card and deploy their last unit. They'll score 3, 1, 2, 3, an additional 1 point for the matching symbol bonus. putting them at 8 and the black player at 7. Of course, they can go back and forth constantly until they no longer have units to deploy because they've run out of cards or simply don't have any more units. Once both players pass, you tally up, and as I mentioned, the gold player has 8 and the black player has 7. So the gold player wins and the black player loses. Then each player will first need to determine how many units they lose. Both sides will lose one unit for every 7 impact points that was dealt to them. And the loser loses one additional unit. Both players will select which blocks they lose, and the attacker will take their losses first, then the defender. When selecting your defeated units, you must first select units from those that defected, then from those that you deployed, and then those that were remaining on the battlefield that weren't deployed. So here, the gold player loses one unit because they were dealt 7 points of damage. So they have to take away this unit that defected first. And then the black player also loses one for the 7 points that was dealt to them, and then one additional one. Set them off to the side of the board to keep as trophies for the other player, but otherwise, they are no longer useful. Then, the loser will retreat. They take any remaining forces that were at their location and move to a location that does not have any enemies, and isn't the location that the enemy came from. So here, the gold player came from Ayabe, so the black player has to run back to Tsuruga. If there were no valid locations, as if there was an enemy here at Tsuruga, and the opponent came from Ayabe, with no legal moves, they can move to any adjacent location. So they could run over to the enemy or run to Ayabe. If they ran to the enemy, this will then ensue another battle. But if, for example, they ran with a large stack of units and they ran to Tsuruga, overrun still applies because they have 4 times as many units than their opponent. They get overran and destroyed immediately. So be careful which fights you pick. If the attacker loses and is forced to retreat, they must retreat to a location where some of the units that started the fight came from. So for example here, if to start this fight I moved in units from Ayabe into Miyazu and another unit from Tsuruga, that means these 3 would combine and then the fight would start. And if I lost, they could move back to Ayabe or back to Tsuruga. If for some reason that is impossible, for example, if the units that started the fight came from off the board, they can't retreat back to being off the board and can instead choose any adjacent location. After the retreats have been done, but before any consecutive fights happen, even as a result of that retreat, the players will draw back some cards based on how many they played. So here the black player played 4, they'll discard those cards they played, and they'll draw back up 4. The gold player played 3, they'll discard those and draw back up 3. And those are the basics of combat. You move to a location, you deploy units to fight off your enemy's forces, and you each would deal damage to each other based on how many units you deployed. The winner gets to stay, and the loser takes their losses and retreats. And just because you arrive with a larger force does not guarantee you the victory. So let's talk about some of the special rules that can come into play when performing combat. There are 2 special cards when it comes to deploying forces. One that has a double symbol and one that has a sword. The double symbol is simpler to explain. When you play it, it acts the same way as any other card. You can deploy a force with the matching symbol, but it also allows you to deploy another unit with the matching symbol. It's a double deployment, back to back. And the second symbol is the one with the sword, which implies a special attack. This effect applies to the units with the gun and cavalry symbols on them. So these cards can be used to deploy normal units as regular. But if you use it to deploy a unit that has a gun or cavalry, they will perform a special attack. So let's say we're having this fight here at Kyoto, and the black player deploys a regular unit card, and they choose to deploy this. They would get 1 point. There's only 1 symbol on it. Alright, the opponent plays their card, they get 2 points. But now the black player plays a card that has the special attack symbol on it. and that card matches this clan symbol, so that they can play it. So they do. They get 1 point for the one symbol. That's great. But because they played the special attack, they get all the bonus points from it, which includes 2 additional points for being a special attack. So this block by itself is worth 3. Then they will score 2 additional points for each other block that matches that special attack. So here they would score 2 additional points for having already played a cavalry unit, even if that unit wasn't used in a special attack. If the unit's there, the symbols match, 2 more points. And they would also still benefit from the matching clan symbols if that applied. So here, by playing 1 card to summon this cavalry as a special attack, they get 5 more points. So if the gold player wanted to beat them back, they could also play a special attack. They'd get 1, plus 2, plus 1 for the matching clan, to put them at 6 as well. However, if the black player were to play another special attack and summon this gun symbol, they would get 4 points for it. 1 for the symbol, 2 for the gun, and then 1 for the matching clan symbols. They wouldn't get these bonus cavalry points of 4 because this is not a cavalry, it's a gun. You only get it for the matching special attack symbol. But luckily, special attacks here are only represented by the sword, which means that they can summon either or, the cavalry or the gun, as long as the clan symbols also match. Lastly, for normal special rules, we have these certain leaders. These leaders with the square in the bottom left corner can be summoned by any card. So when deploying your forces, you can discard any card you'd like to match that special unit for deployment, and you would gain from their benefits. So now let's talk about sieges. Sieges occur if there is a battle at a castle, and the castle owner has 2 or less units at that location. If the castle owner had more than 2 units, it wouldn't be a siege, and instead they would have to fight outside of the castle. And it would be a normal battle as I described before. But if you have 2 or less, you can instead choose to have your castle besieged. These are one-sided battles. The defender doesn't get to play any cards to deploy their forces against their opponent. Instead, it's up to the opponent to deploy their own units to try and score more than 7 points. But they would only suffer casualties if their opponent can manage to do more than 7 points of impact. If they can't, then they failed at the siege, and no casualties are suffered on either side. So let's say here the gold player managed to do at least 7 points of impact damage, which means the defending player will have to suffer 1 casualty. They get to pick, they pick which one, they reveal it, and discard it. There is still a unit at this location, and they could retreat. They could retreat as normal to an adjacent location, or they could retreat to inside the castle. If that are the case, then now both units now exist at this location, and this castle is now considered besieged, and the black player cannot move any of their units out from the castle. Other units may move inside the castle and potentially perform battles, but they can't leave it if their opponent is besieging them. If the besieging player manages to kill all the units at that location, they now own the castle. And in subsequent turns, the black player can optionally choose to perform this battle. Because remember, during the combat step of a turn, you have to do combat at each location where there are 2 units. But because this is a castle, and they have retreated inside the castle, they don't have to go outside and fight them. They can wait for their opponent to ensue the battle on their turn. And there's one additional rule when it comes to sieges. And I also forgot to mention what happens after a normal battle. So after a battle, siege or otherwise, players get cards back up to the number they played. Awesome. But players will also get an additional card for every 2 units that they lost. However, during a siege, the defending player will instead get one card for every unit they lost. So the loss to gain economy is somewhat better in the defending player's favor, and it is harder for your sieging opponent to take out your units inside your castle. So what are these discs? These discs count somewhat like units, except that they can't move or attack. So what are they good for? There's only two in the game, and they both belong to the gold player. Well, when the gold player here is determining their losses in the case of a siege, they could choose to discard this token instead. So their units remain. That's what this is good for. The other disc here represents the leader of the gold army. If they manage to kill this token, that is an instant victory for the black army. The black army can also declare an instant victory if they happen to kill this leader unit with the fancy kanji and the three-star banner or three-circle banner. But don't worry, the gold player can also achieve an instant victory if they manage to kill their opponent's three-star leader banner. So the black player here has two opportunities at instant victory while the gold player only has one. So with all the special rules of combat done and explained, let's go back up to the reinforcement phase of the start of each week. So, as I said, each player gets their two turns, and then we go back to the start of week two. Starting with reinforcements, the phase that we skipped during the first week. The first thing that happens is that both players will discard half of their cards in their hand, rounding down. So here the black player has 6 cards, they'll discard 3, and then they'll draw 5 cards. If they happen to have more castles controlled in their favor than their opponent, they will instead draw 6 cards. Then, depending on the week that it currently is, each player will put a number of random units from their bags into their recruitment box. For week 2, that'll be 2 units. For week 3, it is 2. For week 4, it is 2. And 5, 6, and 7, it is 1. But if you have more resource locations currently under your control than your opponent, you will get to place an additional 1 unit into your box. More recruitment opportunities are a good thing. And that's the refresh phase. The only other special rules that apply is this box that the gold player has. These guys represent Mori Teramoto's army. The gold player has these 5 units in this box at the beginning of the game, but how do they get them? So when it's the gold player's movement phase, they can discard any number of cards to receive that many number of units from that box. When they do that, they take those units and place them to Osaka. Similar to a recruitment, but not technically a recruitment, because this can be done whether or not they discard one card or none. So they could sacrifice cards for these Mori units, and they could discard one to move 3 stacks and do a potential recruitment, or any combination of anything that I've already mentioned. But if Osaka is ever attacked by the Black Army, all the units that are here in this box immediately go to Osaka. So that makes it even harder for the black player to get that instant victory by sieging that castle. When you're sacrificing cards to get these Mori units, the last unit that you will ever get will be the leader. So you can't choose to get it first. It will always be the last one. So with all those crazy rules out of the way, how do you win? I mentioned those 3 ways that the players can instantly win against each other, but if they allow the game to go to 7 weeks, at the end of the 7 weeks, once both players have performed both of their turns, it'll then go to victory points. Each player will receive 2 points for every castle that's under their control, and 1 point for every resource location they control. After tallying up, whoever has the most wins. And that's Sekigahara, the unification of Japan. I hope you've enjoyed this tutorial, and if you have any questions, of course, leave a comment below. Or send me an email at cynicallyawesomegames@gmail.com. This is a really cool historical war game that may look complicated, but it's actually pretty simple in its core gameplay. But that's all for now. Thanks for watching. Let's keep on rolling.